Hello, everyone. How are you? Hello, Jane. Good to see you again. I can see I'm looking good. Dress, well, the jumper's looking good today, nice colours. But I noticed the weather's not looking too good. It's actually pretty wet here. It's 10 o'clock here, and I'm streaming from a hotel room in Moscow. It's cold and dark, but that comes with the territory, I guess. This is me in real time, isn't it? Yeah, we're sharing this time, so it must be real. Whatever it is, anyway. But in some way, this odd condition of being real time or fake time is part of this lecture today and this demonstration. To help you believe that I'm here in real time, of course, I've asked Jane, thanks Jane, to set up the iPhone app that we developed called ComobNet. So before we start, I want you to have a go at using ComobNet and perhaps connect it to me in real time. And Jane will plug it into the big TV and you can see that where I am now, really, in Moscow. And yeah, I know the lecture isn't real time, but sort of it is, isn't it? As long as you believe I'm talking to you. So if you have an iPhone, sorry those using Android, please have a go at this. But if you have an iPhone, take it out, and go to the App Store now, or in a minute. And I think you'll have Wi-Fi now in the tea room. But go to the App Store and download an application called ComobNet. When it's downloaded, it will look a bit like this. And once you've tapped on it, it will look like this. Now, once you're in to the application, go to the Settings tab at the bottom. It looks like this. And the important bit is to put your name in at the top and the name of the group that we're all going to be part of. And the group that we're all going to be part of is Design Space Informatics. So Design Informatics in the group name. And if you put that in lowercase, then we know that we're all in the same group. Then turn your show names on and make sure that we will have all selected at the bottom of the screen. That's it. Then click Map View and watch people arrive. And you'll see me sitting in this, I don't know, I'm in the hotel somewhere. I don't know where I'll be tomorrow, but this is real time, so this is where I am now, don't worry. So hopefully I'll see you in Comob, and you'll see me, and it will all make even more sense when you've listened to this lecture, which is, of course, in real time. Bye. This is all about real time. What is it to be in a space of the present, knowing that as a human you carry the past with you, but because you're part of society, you project into futures. I'm going to try some video in here, and we're going to try some stories. And most of it is predicated on the assumption that we're in a very postmodern context. So most of the 20th century, in fact, most of the millennium, was about constructing a capitalist context in which money, time and space were all very closely bound. Now, whenever I travel, some of the first things I do is check money, how much is a beer, how much is a loaf of bread, and what time is it? What time is it at home? And then perhaps where I am. And those three coordinates are critical in terms of trade, relations, and power. So here you can see currency converters are critical. Knowing where we are, the map obviously remains and still remains a vital coordinate in understanding where we are in place. And then of course time. Now I could have shown a clock here, but what I've introduced is an 11th century Benedictine monk's diary, or at least a timetable for the day. And let's have a look at this in closer detail. It's actually part of Parks and Thrift's book on time, spaces and places, and what it is to be in the context of a geography of knowing, and a geography of knowing yourself through time. Geography and the study of geography is not limited to maps by any means. It's more to do with a human relationship with the world. And through that, of course, timetables are critical. So this is a Benedictine monk's day, and you can begin to see how organized it is. If I see if I can move it as a clock, we'll see how sophisticated it is as well. So in the winter, you can see that preparation for night at 2:30, 3 a.m. the night office. But really the day begins at 5 o'clock with reading, and then daybreak at 6 o'clock, more reading, wash and change. And then on to work, and work moves from 9:45 all the way through to Sung Mass, and then it's dinner at 2 p.m. Work restarts at 2:45 with Vespers, change into night shoes, and then bed by 6:30. Now, summer doesn't change really. What changes is that the hour changes and we move things around. But what's critical is that the work is a significant part of the day, so is eating and then prayers, but it constitutes really what we begin to realize is a contemporary timetable. And if you look at the design informatics timetable, you'll realize that we've constructed a similar timetable for you. So around the 11th century in the UK, we understand that these relations, these timetables, really begin to be part of what we now understand to be the modern timetable. And it doesn't take very long to begin to construct what is the working day. Now, what was interesting about Thrift's writing on the timetable of Benedictine monks was how you begin to understand what it might have been like around the 11th, 12th, 13th centuries of those people who have time and those who don't have time. So while the monks, if you like, the Benedictine monks have concept of time, many people don't have time, and he talks about what might it be like to not have time. All of you are very, very used to time. You're acutely aware of its affordances, the time you need to get to different places, the time it takes to do things. You're very sophisticated people, and you carry a clock with you, now probably in the form of a mobile phone, with you all of the time. But people didn't have time. So let's spend some time trying to think of what it might be like not to have time. Thrift uses this phrase, this quote from him: natural rhythms dictate the pace of life and work without time, and the content of language. And any expectation of a future centers on a short lifespan and the imminence of a day of judgment, people of great temporal innocence. So what he's suggesting is that without a clock going off in the background, without your watch or your smartphone in your pocket, natural rhythms are the things that control your model of time. So weathers, all of you, the sense of season and how the seasons change are your models of time. So you do have a year, but you're waiting for that to move from cold through to warm, through to hot, back to a sense of less warm, maybe less hot into the warm, and back into cold again, and that constitutes your year. And you will have, of course, seasonal celebrations, rituals and things such as Easter and some form of Christmas and some form of summer solstice, as the seasons and the sun dictate some kind of timetable, some coordinates in the year. But other than that, you're pretty naive, you're pretty innocent, and a lot of you don't know what's coming next. At the same point in time, the church and belief systems dominate your sense of what time means. So knowing what's coming next, or any sense of future, may well be dominated by a church that tells you that if you've been bad, or something is happening to the weather, then it's because you've been bad, and that any point in time will be managed by the control of that space. So the idea of a day of judgment, the idea of something coming soon which is going to be bad, or the end of the world, will be oriented or blamed on your activities in that ecology. In that same time though, that we began to see words being written and gathered, and
the monks had a particular power because they could read and write. Reading and writing, as I said the other day, does constitute a particularly rich model of knowing. You're all able to take notes, and you're able to constitute some idea of a database or a memory, and you're also able to, you're doing this because you know in future you'll be able to use these notes, so you'll be able to push them out and pull them and refer to them in the future. And St. Augustine was particularly interesting because he talks about this temporal consciousness, because you can see actually from this picture that what he's doing is constructing writing, and he's writing into the future, but he knows he's documenting for what other people will become their past. He's also spends a lot of time writing to God, writing to someone who is supposed to be all-seeing in space and in time. And how does St. Augustine feel about that strange idea of writing into? Is it that God knows what he's about to write always, and God knows his future messages? How is it to have a Bible or a testament that lets you look at the past, which other people's writings is constituted on, and then the apostles and the disciples, and then reference that 1,000 years later, and then write on top of that? Makes for a very complicated model of time, particularly in which that we're best to understand that a God might, again, travel outside and beyond this time, and in theory has the trigger on the clock, and at any point God can say, right, stop, it's judgment time. Have you been good? Have you been bad? Which way are you going to go, down to hell or up to heaven? So you begin to get this very complicated idea of time and space. What was, as the church gathered time, both through its sense of temporal consciousness, through its writing, and through managing the communities around it with bells, it began to organise time and space. So, in this piece of writing, clocks were the next step at handing over time from the church day to the individual. Instead of responding to the church bell, people could be organised from specific blocks of time. So, what you begin to find is that the bell becomes this organising power. I suggest organised because the reader of the clock is the one with the power, and as Harvey suggests, such time discipline crucially depends on the construction of distinctive spaces of surveillance, and consequently it isn't long before we recognise a capitalist system in place. So by me ringing a bell, bringing you into this room, or me ringing a bell and bringing people from the fields, I begin to construct a sense of control. I can manage you, I can count, because I've got writing, of course, I can count how many potatoes you brought in, or the crops you brought in, and I can account for those things. That's another form of writing. So I can have an account system from last year or the year before, and I know how well you're doing with your crops. I could even, if I was very mean, if I think you're not doing very well with the crops, I could actually construct a story that says you need to work harder. I could even construct a story that says that, well, if the weather's been bad, maybe that's because you haven't been working hard enough. So with the clock in hand and the accounts in hand, you can begin to construct an economy. To be honest, it could be an economy of fear, but it could also be an economy of faith, that we believe in what we're doing. So clock time, as it begins to take form from the bell slowly into being a clock, where we have not just small time and incremental time, but very sophisticated time, not just hours, but we actually begin to have a sense of minutes, I guess, eventually, that you begin to get this very sophisticated time consciousness. And clock time forms an integral part of contemporary Western society's time consciousness. Time efficiency, time budgeting, time management, they all belong to the clock time conceptualization of time, as Barbara Adams tells us. So all of you aren't a better timed people than you are space people. And I think about my kids who now are in school, and they're absolutely brought up as soon as they go to nursery on a very sophisticated model of time. They start the bell, start school at 8:30, or I think both of them start at 8:30 these days. And as the bell goes, they move in. They know that there's a series of classes, and they move through segments of classes. They all have clocks on. There's a big clock in each of the classrooms, which is now even on data projectors. And they understand the day very, very well. And it's actually a day that looks not dissimilar to the Benedictine monks' timetable as well. Of course, the time is connected to the map. And in later lectures, we're going to talk about how space is produced and how the clock is deeply connected to the clock. And the time. So as clock was a measuring device, so was the map, and the generation was linked to this same generation was linked to the same issues that motivated early Westerners to develop such a device for measuring time, interests of trade and commerce, of property and territorial rights. So later in the semester, when we talk about economy, we'll refer back to maps as this process of controlling time and space. So as we move through the 20th century, this position of this management of time, which becomes pretty endemic, pretty spread, certainly across the UK, we begin to understand how it plays a part in what we now know as modernity. This idea that managing time and space and money means that you can produce artifacts, control land, develop workforces, go to war efficiently, and, as we can see from the picture, construct train tracks and build transport systems. Now, what you're looking at there is a 19th century etching of a beginning to see trains. Now, what's really important with trains is that in the UK and across the world, nations and countries had their own time zones. So you're used to the idea that UK having a time zone and Paris and France having a time zone ahead of us, 1 hour, so on and so forth. And you're aware of China being multiple time zones back home. So as trains came in, trains could run regionally. We had Western railways, we had the Eastern railways, we had Midlands railways, and each of them actually had entirely different time zones. This proved a bit of a problem. The time zones are actually based on the sun, and it meant that where I used to be down in Devon, Plymouth, it used to work 12 minutes or so behind London. So you have regional trains working around a concept of their midday, and their midday would be very local. However, Bradshaw, as the train network developed through the 19th century, suggested that this was unfeasible if we were going to move to a national train system. So around the 1850s, he developed the Bradshaw timetable, and it became a very large part of what we now understand to be the UK model of time. So he set to develop a national train system, but it used London time. So Greenwich Mean Time through the late 19th century became the only time that we know, and villages gave way to London time, and we began to, through the train, set all of our clocks on London time. And I've only grown up with London time. I don't know what it would be like to have a natural time or a local time based on the sun. So you begin to understand how, even quite late really, through the last millennium, that we began to deal with time as a national concept. Places in France, the trains in France set their clocks 5 minutes ahead, so that actually there was a 5 minute contingency. And let me think I've got that right. So people coming in from the villages knew that they had a 5 minute buffer to get the train. So actually it wasn't early, was it? 5 minutes, trains set themselves 5 minutes late, so that if you were 5 minutes late, you still had the time to get the train. So time has been manipulated through modernity, and it's something that we now are very constrained to. It's very, very hard to think of any other models of time. In fact, your weekends were developed 7 days a week, orientated around the idea that that religion and faith, and we have a Sabbath, but actually the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, were constructed because of largely through modernity, and we have an idea that trade took place at the weekend, essentially because we all worked so damn hard, we produced a lot of things, and we produced money for ourselves, but that meant that we had to spend it. So you have a surplus of working time, means that we have to construct a time in which to spend money to regulate the economy. But again, we'll talk about more of this in week 8. Now, as we leave the 20th century, sorry, the 19th century, move into the 21st century, we begin to find different technologies, and modernity is very good at constructing technologies that bent time and space to make more money. And we invest futures in the context of technology. There is a technological determinism that emerged through the 20th century, as we found that technology could take us to places, it would make promises, and the trains are no different. This is a train advert from the 1980s, where I grew up, and its slogan was simply, "We're getting there," and it promised an idea that the future would be promised. It would come, and it would come faster and faster and faster. So "we're getting there" is part of a vocabulary of the 20th century, an idea that we will always be getting better. We will be improving as we fund more and more technological projects. Over here, we've got Microsoft Start Me Up campaign, which the slogan was, "Where do you want to go today?" Another promise of the future, another technological determinism. Now, the late 20th century have been used to this. We were promised lots of things. As we move from a condition of modernity where we began to less rely on God's saving us, we began to move to a space where technology would save us. And if it wasn't trains, it quickly became computers that they would save us. And through the 20th century, we've learnt to worry about some of these, perhaps in our generation. Our parents, though, put a lot of faith in technology. The nuclear projects were all going to save us from coal and heavy carbon-loaded technologies of power and energy, and we would put faith in nuclear. Then Chernobyl happens and we lose faith, and now you can see Germany has actually retracted its investments in nuclear, and we're beginning to find a condition where we don't trust nuclear power. So there has been and continues to be a terrific amount of technological determinism which pervades some of the technology that you guys are going to be developing in. We have a lot of faith in these futures, but it is a critical problem because we now believe that the next technology will be better than the last technology, and it projects us into a future in which we believe arrows and we believe things to come and improve, and we have words such as progress, which we expect to develop all of our technologies. Now, these lines, these progress bars, if you like, are all connected back to a type of belief system which we have as a contemporary society, in which these arrows are part of what we believe to be futures, that you're all part of this arrow here, that you will join design futures and you will end design futures as a better, smarter designer, computer scientist, and you have faith in this line. We've constructed a narrative for you to invest in. But that's no different to any other part of your lives. You've invested in lines and futures, and to be at the edge of that cutting edge of that point is the best place to be. Now, it might be that these things are flawed, that these are known as teleologies. Teleologies are models of time that have a start, middle, and end. They're frameworks, and you've been brought up with these frameworks. You've been brought up with the idea that things should have an arc. A story arc, a start, a middle, and a complete end. And we believe in these things. We don't just, and it's very, very hard to move away from them, from because they're part of society, they're part of our bodies now, and they're part of what we understand to be lives. Lives are things that have start, middle, and end. So a teleology is critical, and we saw the effects of this belief in teleologies toward the end of the 20th century, when actually the end of the second millennium, we believed that the world could possibly end. We invested millions of pounds in the millennium bug, largely an insurance scam, where our doubt and our lack of faith in computer systems suggested that they would all fail us. And if computer systems fail us, then health systems fail us, banking systems fail us, airplanes fall out of the sky. And it constituted really an Armageddon around a belief system that really was largely untenable and really was a very, very good insurance scam. At the same time, this fear was expressed through movies. Here we see, I think it was Judgment Day or Armageddon, there was The Day After Tomorrow, more recently we have 2012, loads of movies that deal with the idea that the world really is going to end. And if you remember, I don't know how old you were, maybe you were young teenagers, but many, many movies were situated in this absolute fear that the world is going to end. Not a millennium bug, but often with apocalypse of Armageddon, which was asteroids landing on Earth. It could have been The Day After Tomorrow, which was a terrible ecological disaster. All of them posit a genuine fear for the end. The end being at the end of this arrow, the idea that things are going to end. And this end is pretty well documented now. Ironically, we got through it. And funnily enough, we now seem to be still, we still face some disaster movies, but particularly around the year 2000, there were many, many of these things. What was interesting, I think, from the perspective of looking at popular culture as a way of understanding ourselves, is that we also know that soon after that, the teleological Armageddon movies, is that we had a bunch of movies now which have no endings. Inception, which is after Judgment Day, if you like, has an ending where we don't know what happens to our hero. If you remember the end of Inception, you're left with a spinning thing. You have movies such as, I'm thinking now, Source Code, which is all about models of time, but it takes you out of a bubble of time and places you back into the concept of code being the thing that changes. Prior to all of these, we had a great interest in the X-Files and the supernatural, as though we were uncertain about some of our grand narratives and some of our futures. So teleologies are a part of you. They're part of your bodies. They're part of how you write. They're part of how I tell stories through this lecture. They have story arcs. Now, it might be that when we talk about code and programming and design informatics, that these things won't have story arcs. Scanning data all the time means that maybe real time won't be something which is all about teleologies. Of course, Apple and this is the five, you'll recognise that, sorry, this is the four. I'm out of date already, I'm out of time. What you can see here is the iPhone 4 as it was portrayed, a beautiful rendered image, and there's Johnny about to tell you. Of course, the 4 is now out of date, and the 5 is where we need to be, or the 5S. And we need to be probably muting rumours about what's going to be in the 6. So concepts of newness, concepts of what's next in the technological determinism, if you like, what's next for the future, is that we believe these things will be better. And you look at the stats of the iPhone 5, and they outstrip the 4 by, you know, twofold, threefold, fourfold, and the 5S is extremely fast. So we believe that technology will keep getting us better and making the world a better place. And we invent stories such as FaceTime to develop that. So I'm now going to take you on a much darker story and talk about what it is then to be in a real-time context, and how technology has changed that sense of real time. You know, from all your Teflon saucepans and your natural air sponge mattresses, foam mattresses. But it also has been a space in which telecommunications, the concept of real time, have been stretched. That being out in space and being in contact with astronauts or cosmonauts has been a critical need. And it's meant that as it's developed through the middle of the 20th century, we've had to keep in touch. But of course, some of the times and spaces involved are pretty extraordinary. Apollo 1 was a terrible disaster. And this is Cape Canaveral in 1967. And during that time, the NASA were developing a whole different bunch of technologies to keep ahead of the space race. And this is the spacecraft, which unfortunately burnt out on the tower, the control tower, during a routine test. And it burnt out and it killed every astronaut involved. So it wasn't going to launch, they were just running through some tests, but it was a terrible tragedy and it shocked America and it slowed down, or it made them think twice about that space race. You can see the guys going in here. Now what's fascinating is that it's going to stay on the ground because it's a test, and they're just running through some procedures, but because it stays on the ground, it actually simulates being as far away from ground as you can imagine, because it's projecting a test which would actually occur in space. So you've got this beginning to see these very odd discrete time spaces where people are testing things, but actually in real time, but out on the ground. So this real time accident occurs. So it's a terrible fire starts, and because of the conditions, the locked door, which ironically is only openable from the outside, in future space technology they have handles on the inside, but on the door on the outside is locked, and these guys perish and die in a terrible death. So let's have a look at some of the transcripts. Now NASA have to, because they have a public liability, they report everything. So you begin to find some fantastic documents that tell us about what happened. So this is the report of the fire. So from the T10 minute hold at 23:20 GMT until the report of the fire. And what you'll notice straight away is that we're working in GMT time. We know that this is in Texas, and yet we know they're working on an international model of time. So we already see how the report is affected by a concept of time. So from the start of the T10 minute hold at 23:20 GMT until about 23:30, there were no events that appeared to be related to the fire. The major activity during the period was routine, troubleshooting the communications problem. The records show that except for the communications problems, all systems were operating normally during this period. There were no voice transmissions from the spacecraft in 23:30-14. GMT until the transmission reporting the fire, which began at 23:31:04.7 GMT, which there we get the first clue that actually this is not European Standard Time, but and actually it's 6:30 in the evening. For me, that means the kids have just finished watching The Simpsons on Channel 4. I don't know what 6:30 means for you, maybe getting ready for tea. So what's also critical is you can see the temporal clarity at 23:31, that's 6:31 in the evening, 4 seconds past that minute, and then a seventh fraction of that time. So seven one-sevenths of a second. Sorry about that. So you begin the accuracy that data has started to be gathered. During the period beginning about 30 seconds before the report, there are indications of crew movement. These indications are provided by the data from the biomedical sensors, the command pilot's live mic, the guidance, the navigation system, and the environmental control system. So we also begin to know that all of the suits are rigged up. like a quantified self. They're all rigged up, and the guys are streaming data back into the mission headquarters. There is, however, no evidence as to what this crew movement was or that it was related to the fire. So the team just know that there's movement around. The biomedical data indicates that just prior to the fire report, the senior pilot was performing essentially no activity or was in the baseline rest condition. Until about 23:30, 21 GMT, when a slight increase in pulse and respiratory rate was noted. At 23:30, 30 GMT, the electrocardiogram indicates some muscular activity for several seconds. Similar indications are noted at 23:30, 39 GMT. The data showed increased activity that are not indicative of an alarm type of response, but by 23:30, 45 GMT, all of the biomedical parameters had reverted to the baseline rest level. So at that point, they conclude people are dead. Beginning at about 23:30 GMT, the command pilot live microphone transmitted brushing and tapping noises, which are indicative of movement. The noises are similar to those transmitted early in the test by the live mic when the command pilot is known to have been moving. These sounds end at 23:30, 58.6. So is that death? Any significant crew movement results in minor motion of the command module. This motion is detected by the guidance and navigation system and is indicative of crew movement. However, the type of movement cannot be determined. Data from this system indicates a slight movement at 23:30, 24 GMT, with more intense activity beginning at 23:30, 39 GMT. More movement begins at 23:31, 00 GMT and continues until loss of data transmission during the fire. So there's a terrible idea that actually that there's a slight movement at 24 seconds and that increases to intense activity at 39, and then 20 seconds later it loses. So is that death? Is that the activity? 23:30, 39 is the activity of people moving around trying to deal with a tremendous burst of fire. And with a scale of oxygen in that cockpit, it would be a horrendous fireball. So death takes, 21 seconds? Increases of oxygen flow rate to the crew suits also indicate movement. All suits have some sort of leakage. The leakage rate varies with crew positions. Earlier in the plugs out test, the crew reported that a particular movement, the nature of which was unspecified, provided increased flow rate. This is also confirmed from the flow rate data records. The flow rate showed a gradual rise at 23:30, 24 GMT, which reaches the limit of the sensor at 23:30, 59. There is a variation at 23:30, 50 GMT and the signal output from the gas chromatograph cable. The gas chromatograph was not installed in the command module. When the gas chromatograph is not connected, the cable acts as an antenna. Thus, changes in the electromagnetic field within the spacecraft are sensed when the cable is approached closely, touched or moved, or voltage fluctuations occur in other equipment. Variations found in the signal level from the gas chromatograph cable at earlier times in the test have been correlated with either crew movement or voltage transients when equipment was turned off or on these earlier times. The variation at 23:30, 50 GMT may have resulted because it was touched or approached by the crew, since there does not appear to be any voltage transient condition at this time, which could have given the observed signal. So it's very clever that they're beginning to use any data that they can. They haven't got a particular sensor plugged in, the gas chromatograph, but actually they're able to use it because it's part of an electromagnetic system. It gives them feedback. It gives them a sense of real-time data, which is all recorded. A significant voltage transience was recorded at 23:30, 54.8 GMT. The records show a surge in the AC to bus voltage. And you might want to think, is that spark? Is that the spark of the fire that records the end? Several other parameters being measured also showed anomalous behavior at this time. There was a 1.7 second dropout in signal from the C-band decoder and transmitter outputs, a brief dropout of the VHF FM carrier and a fluctuation in the rotation controller, no outputs, and a fluctuation in the gas chromatograph signal. So that's the report. And that must be the death of those three astronauts. Strange that the only thing they have to go on, remember, because the nature of the wreck is so total that there isn't anything. There is no evidence. The only evidence they've got is really in the quality of the data that has been poured out in real time to the mission control. And to pour over those then constitutes an analysis. Analysis not of material, and of course they do pour over the material, but it's the analysis of the data which constitutes the bulk of the NASA report. Those real-time, highly calibrated temporal instances where they notice change and difference. So on to a second, and this is 20 years later, when Challenger, the space shuttle, explodes. And we've got more data this time, but what we also find is that we've got people involved on the outside. We've got the general public. Many of the, and it wasn't a test, it was an actual launch. And the tragedy happens not just at Cape Canaveral, but it happens across the whole of America, perhaps the whole of the world, as we all watch a terrible tragedy. So I'll let you watch this one first.
T-minus 15 seconds. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start. 4, 3, 2, 1. And liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Control program.
Roger, roll, Challenger.
Good, roll program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange. Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. 2,257 feet per second. Altitude 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up. Three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go and throttle up.
Challenger, go and throttle up.
Minute 15 seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles. Carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction. We have no downlink.
But what you've been listening to is the sound of the commentator. Now the commentator is actually, it sounds like a member of NASA, and what he is doing is reading data from a screen. Now you saw that and you heard throughout that he was citing data, just numbers, as we were watching the actual events in terms of the material events. Let's just revisit that again, and I want to highlight something specific to you.
Program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange.
So you can hear the data downrange. What does that mean to anyone else?
Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%.
All percent, all data.
We'll throttle down to 65% shortly.
Now, is it goes, explodes, I want you to, I'm going to count.
Altitude 4.3 nautical miles, downrange distance 3 nautical miles.
I'm going to count the time it takes for him to stop reading the data.
Engines throttling up, 3 engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now he stops talking after 8 seconds, but he doesn't stop citing data in that time, so he wasn't watching the screen. 8 seconds, within 8 seconds the data was still pushing, so where was the real-time accident? Because we saw it happening before us, and then someone must have come up to this guy, tapped him on the shoulder, said, don't look at the screen, look at the other screen, look at the TV screen.
Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation.
So we're faced with this very interesting opportunity to begin to understand the gap between ourselves and data. There is this lag, there is this continuum, this space between which we'll never know the world truly. Now if we look at the reports as it moves through in terms of transcript, we can find a very interesting kind of movement between qualitative information, which is based on people talking, expressing themselves, and NASA data. So we'll jump in here with 2 minutes till launch, and you can begin to see people are tagged. CDR is Scobie and PLT is Smith and so on and so forth. And I'll just move through. You can see the difference in quality. You can see around here we've got a security blanket mentioned, which sounds like a joke between friends. At other times we've got NASA stating more information, more data about what's going on. So we've always got this qualitative and quantitative dimensions. Let's move down. More laughing. There goes the beanie cap, which is the cap, the vent cap is taken away. I see it. God, I hope not, Ellison. I couldn't see it moving. It was behind the center screen. Got your harnesses locked. What for? I won't lock mine. I might have to reach something. Okay. So quite a chatty space. This is very different to the Apollo 1 data that you're getting. Very, very social. Very people-centered. And we've got all of this stuff. Again, we've got NASA coming in with caution warning alarms, routine occurrence. Cabin pressure is acceptable. External tank ullage pressure. And meanwhile, we've all got these people. It was yesterday too. Okay, 30 seconds down there. Remember the red button when you make that roll call? I won't do that. Thanks a lot. 15. There they go, guys. All right, 3 at 100. Now, this is when the NASA data that you're familiar with comes in. Thrust level 100% for all engines. All right, here we go. Houston Challenger roll program. Go, you mother. And now this... you didn't hear the voices in the TV footage. You have to kind of read this. And NASA's reminding for cockpit switch for configuration change, local, vertical, horizontal. Someone's swearing. It's damn hot or whatever. Okay, looks like we've got a lot of wind here today. Yeah, looks a little too hard to see out the window here. There's 10,000 feet, the Mach 0.5 altitude velocity report, which you will have heard. Garble 0.9, that's Mach 1, going through 19,000 feet. More altitude reports, which you heard earlier, all mixed with these people, these human beings. Okay, we're throttling down, throttled up to 104% after maximum dynamic pressure. Throttle up, roger, feel that mother go. Woohoo! 35,000 feet going through 1.5. Altitude velocity report, 35,000, 1.5. Reading 486 on mine. Routine airspeed indicator check. Yep, that's what I've got to. Roger, go up, throttle up. SSME 104%, PLT, uh-oh, and then loss of all data. Now again, that's what we're streaming now. We're streaming all of the time, everywhere around us is this data being pushed and pulled. And of course, there's always a level of mediation. And in this context, the mediation between the chap who was reading the data and the TV screen, which was streaming apparently real-time footage, was just out by eight seconds. You couldn't reconcile. And obviously the sensors were still working. What's interesting more recently is the guy, I forget his name, who jumped from the edge of space. That was purported to be real time, but actually delayed it again, perhaps because of these Challenger experiences. How do you explain to the world when things go wrong? What is the right time and the right time of real time? So bringing us back down to the street now, back down to somewhere perhaps normal. This is Edinburgh. And Edinburgh is a complicated real-time city. When you look out of the window, what time do you think people are in? Do you think they're in leisure time? Looking at these people here, is this a retired tourist? Or is it a worker on a coffee break? Is this guy homeless or is he selling things? Is she holding on to two kids down here? So she's perhaps a mum? Or is she holding shopping? When are these guys tourists or are they just coming out of work? Or are they out of work completely? We don't know much about all of these people, but we do know that they're all different people and they probably all have different times of the city. All of you have different times of the city. Some of you have lived here before, some of you, for you it's new. Some of you have more resources than others, some of you don't. Some of you have good access than others. So it makes the city an entirely different, very contested space. What we do know is that many of you are now walking this city with smartphones though. So the city is depicted through applications such as Google Earth, and you're walking with maps in your pocket. Now, the interesting thing with Google Earth is we know it's not real time, don't you? I mean, you get the blue dot, and the blue dot falls, or the pin falls, and the arrow falls and tells you where you are. But underneath that, you know that you're looking at JPEGs from a couple of years ago. This is a good example of Beijing. And you can see that they can't quite get a snapshot here of Beijing, which hasn't got a bit of cloud cover to it. And you can see that down here we've got seem to have different contrast of colour. So all the time Google are replacing. Now the funny thing is you can buy time though. And the Chinese Olympics, the Beijing Olympics, they bought fresher time. So they collaborated with Google and they sent air balloons up in the sky to short circuit or to speed up the time of the ground. So these pictures of the bird nest were taken from helicopters and airships above Beijing, so that when people recognise Beijing, they wouldn't see a two-year-old building site, but they would actually see the bird's nest as though it might be seen within months or weeks of the actual Olympics. So the ground, even in Google, is never true. There's never any real time to it. And of course, all the time, we're beginning to get astronauts starting to tweet. Soichi Noguchi is on the space station and sends live tweets 10 hours ago from TwitPic. So I'm confused now where I do trust the ground. Is that really the ground, or has that been mediated by some of the Japanese agencies to make sure it is the right thing? Because it probably is part of an ISS media campaign as well. So I think it's real. Now, I'm going to throw you another clip now. This time, our hero is Denzel Washington, and we're going to watch him in the movie Deja Vu. And it's going to try and, I think it explains quite interesting your condition, this condition of not knowing when you're in a place. You think you know where, but you don't know when. And that may well be a critical problem for design informatics. Let's see if this plays. So let's have a go at this. Now this is our hero, Denzel, and what he's doing, he's now working for American agency, and the American agency, these guys, they've figured out that they can take all of the sensors from America, all of the sensors, and they can process them and then construct a real-time perspective of space. Now, 36 hours ago, that man in that car, not him, the other car, killed somebody. So Denzel is now taking the feeds from all of these sensors and is reconstructing real time 36 hours ago. And now what he's doing is chasing someone in real time. We know that he can't catch that person physically, but what he can do is chase a ghost of him in real time. So we will never see the actual car on the road. What we will always see is the car there in 36 hours ago. And as he chases him down, of course he has to travel on the wrong side of the road. Now, the technical thesis is here that the sensors are so so much data, you can't reconstruct reality and play it back. It takes 36 hours to construct CGI idea of the past. But it's enough to allow you to chase the past. But of course, like all good sci-fi, it all goes a bit crazy. But arguably, this is what I think you and many people in the city are experiencing. Many of the people in the city are experiencing multiple times of Edinburgh. Some people are up on the castle experiencing a 17th century or a 13th century idea of Scotland and Edinburgh. Other people are down in the new parts of Edinburgh experiencing something very 21st century. Some people are over on and shopping in the High Street. Some are even reading Harry Potter and having Harry Potter cups of tea in fake Harry Potter shops. So the city is never in time. It can't be understood to be in time. In fact, the city sells itself out of a real time to make sure it's part heritage, part history, and part novel, and part new. And of course, you guys are on the edge. You're the new part of the city. But it does mean that all the time we're selling the city as being different times. When I was in Liverpool, in England recently, I managed to pick up leaflets of the opportunities to understand the city. And of course, I can relive Liverpool through the Beatles. Or I could take a ghost walk through Liverpool. Or I could take a photographic tour, which probably mashed up some ideas of the Beatles and the football and the ghosts. So the city is always a story, and time in some ways is always a story. And it means that when we now negotiate the city through iPhones and through electronic media, we can expect to receive a whole different raft of different perspectives. Let's have a quick look at this old advert.
So how does the iPhone make traveling easier? Well, if you'd like your own personal tour of Paris, there's an app for that.
You're standing at the center of France.
Or you'd like to figure out the metro. There's an app for that. Or you'd like to send a postcard home. There's an app for that too. Because there's an app for just about anything, only on the iPhone.
Well, not anymore. We've got other platforms, as you know. But what was interesting is that the city in each of those places was recast, re-represented, and the priority time shifted according to whatever market was being portrayed. Now, this city is very interesting as well. This is London, actually, and these are GPS trails taken from the various taxis. And what's happening here is that we're beginning to see the taxis in the early hours of the morning begin to move through London. So there aren't many taxis, believe it or not, at 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning. But as we slowly move toward 9 o'clock, we can begin to almost make out, you can see the river here, you can see a zone one here with probably Piccadilly Circus and Leicester Square in the middle. And you really get a sense of the intensity, the closeness of that matrix of those networks. And these are all taken from GPS tracks from taxis. So the city can be understood to be this place, but it's one perhaps of flow, and that perhaps the landscape changes. I mean, look how dense it is here compared when it was at 4 o'clock in the morning, and that's Andrew Marr. When you enter the middle of the day, the streets become very, very intense, and it's an entirely different city, and that must change the time. It takes longer to get across town than it would to in the middle of the night. So cities have to be understood as time, possibly more than space, although splitting the two subjects is tricky. Being connected through digital media, of course, connects you to a whole load of different times and places and people and spaces. Now, contemporary culture has wrestled this problem well through a number of movies, and I'm going to just sample some of these movies now and explain how time has never been a line for many cultural contexts. And some of the media that I expect you to make will explore the fact that technology isn't a line anymore, and actually technology repeats itself again and again and again. And maybe we don't know where we're going. Maybe we haven't got the best way to express ourselves. One of these movies is Inglourious Basterds by Tarantino, which particularly from an American perspective, Tarantino decides to entirely rewrite the Second World War, which... Tarantino, quite cheekily really, felt that the Second World War didn't deal with the Germans properly, the Third Reich or the Nazis, if you like, the SS. So he rewrote history. And this idea here is that instead of looking back on history with a view to try and recover or re-engineer history, actually he just says, well, why don't we just rewrite history? Let's pretend that a German cinematographer, a Jewish woman who owns a cinema, actually manages to destroy and collect all the Third Reich in one space and destroys all of them in one incredible firestorm within a cinema. So here we see them gathering, and there's the cinema. And by bringing them all together, she expects to kill all of them. Now, it's entire fiction. But what's fascinating is that the Americans, who have a not nearly as deep a history as Europe or China, what they do is they have the ability to just rewrite history. And that's what, in some ways, design informatics needs to take on board. We have to be prepared to look at new fictions, new histories, in order to construct new futures, different ways of beginning to think about how we relate to each other, how we use different technologies. Now, it's a very American opportunity. I don't think the British would dream of doing this. I don't think it would even enter our psyche. But we probably have to be aware of these opportunities to think, let's just not do it like the way it happened. Let's take it all again and rewrite it. So, on to another example. White Ribbon is by Michael Haneke. And White Ribbon is a very, very interesting, quite hard story. This is a story about a town, a little village actually, in Germany, but in just before the breakout of the First World War, which is, I guess, 1916, if I've got my history right. It's early 19-teens. But what's interesting here is that there are some bad people in the town, and they include the vicar, the priest, if you like, the landowner. The school teacher here has seen his education as the good guy. But what happens is that we find that there are some horrible things happening in the town. And in the end, it appears that the children are probably doing it. But then the children are being subjected to bad things. They're being abused. They're being controlled. It's not a very nice place to work or live or grow up. So what happens is we know as being, because of history, because where we are, we're down the line down here. This film is taking place here. And what we begin to do at the start of the First World War is realise that all of these kids, who turn out to be little monsters really, because they're beginning to be affected and change the way we think of good behaviour, all of these kids turn out to be part of the Second World War. And probably the German part of the Second World War that does terrible things. So by what Haneke's doing very, very cleverly is we don't know how the film ends, because the film is situated in the just before the First World War. But we do know, because of who we are, how the Second World War goes. So it means all of these children become futures that we know about more intimately. And we never see them as grown-ups, we only ever see them as kids. And then the last one is both film and book, of course, which is The Reader. And this is more intergenerational, where we have a woman who is, I'm guessing at being about 30, and we have a young boy who's a teenager. And really, it's an intergenerational sense of time. That really, what we're doing is, because She, if you like, she was caught up in SS prisoner issues, that she's actually guilty. And she's guilty because of her age and her connection. And it means it creates a problem of a young boy who doesn't understand perhaps what it's like to be guilty. He doesn't see the guilt and the complicity. But we end up with this very interesting turn where actually time is also incredibly complicated. What's interesting is that his father is her age. So it makes for a very complicated sense of guilt. By association, if she's guilty and she confesses, is his father who isn't saying anything. So you get these very interesting problems of how we begin to blame time and blame the people of a certain time. So media has done very well to manipulate time. Pulp Fiction, Memento, Inception, lots of examples where we're beginning to see time manipulated and played out as opposed to a non-linear model to something much more complex. Now, of course, as I presented in the seminar the other week, digital systems extend not just a non-linear, but a truly complex digital model of time, one which is networked and travelling at incredibly high speeds. Most of the media you and I used to does travel in a linear path. You go from A, B, C, D. But when computer systems travel so fast, as we talked about last week, that you begin to get very complex, very fast, out-of-time circumstances. So in this example, you remember that E-mini had fallen by so much money, 1.9 billion, in just 4.5 minutes, because of two dueling algorithms, two pieces of code that are written along to operate and trade across these extraordinary fiber optic networks, which are all saving tiny amounts of milliseconds, just saving a little bit. Now, this is the speed of data. All of you, through Design Informatics, will now be operating on speeds where you won't be satisfied unless you're getting a real-time return. And you can't have that. It'll only be as good as your speed that you can get a connection to across the network. So I'm really interested in how you're going to begin to start dealing with not only with ubiquity that we covered last week, which is this breadth and this spread of technology, but also this extraordinary speed which is going to operate. When people are talking about making millions of pounds by shaving milliseconds off trades, and what happens to you? It's a different time, of course, to St. Augustine. St. Augustine was dealing with a temporal consciousness. He wasn't like the guys who were having to wrestle with... well, maybe he was. Maybe he's exactly like these guys. Maybe these guys are dealing with a time which is outside of them, in the same way that St. Augustine was dealing with a time that was outside him. Only he's having to reconcile his experience of time as he learns to read and write and store things, just like you are reading and writing. And he's writing his code. You can see him writing code there. And his query, his letters to God, are equally as confused as these guys who are beginning to understand that they don't operate anymore in a world in which the clock is ticking away with a time that they can understand. It's travelling much, much faster. Now, this space of new temporal consciousness, and I do think over this semester we need to understand what is the temporal consciousness of design informatics when data and algorithms are constructing spaces. We can begin to talk about different possibilities. I think it makes a very interesting design space for you all. One of my favourite television adverts, which I think I showed last week, is this opportunity to think about futures. In this phone advert, you might remember, we talked about knowing so much about the world that patterns begin to build. Now, I don't know if you've found your pattern yet for Design Informatics or Edinburgh, but my pattern has been pretty set for 4 years now. I get one of two trains into Edinburgh, and if you want to find me in the morning, you could be close to those two trains and you would find me. If you wanted me to predict what was happening next, I have a good experience of those time frames. Now we're beginning to find software applications open up some of those examples, and we're beginning to find that certain iPhone apps are starting to see into the future. I've got an app called 4C, which tells me when it's a good time to mow my lawn. So by correlating different data sets, you can begin to predict futures. And that's what's beginning to happen in this. We see that idea that in these spaces, people are literally seeing into futures. And to what extent will you be able to see and predict and develop a type of product or a type of way of designing, a way of being? Now, they might not be physical artifacts. It might just be a way of thinking about what your companies begin to start seeing. So this is new space that I want you to really think about. It's a space in which evidently money in economies are tied to, and we'll talk about that in a few weeks' time. It's one in which space is for sure part of, but it's also been cut up and exploited and, if you like, made flexible by the use of time. And then, there are times, and we're moving critically from timetables which were fixed to far more fluid times. Many of you don't coordinate meetings anymore by asking each other to pick times. What you do is say, hey, do you want to go out for a drink tonight? And then slowly you will text and organise that closer to the time. 10 years ago, people would have to write a letter or maybe send an email. But, you know, 20 years ago, it was certainly a letter that informed, I would like to see a student on this day, unless you met them in person to arrange. So it had to be an entirely different organisation of time and space and people. So that's real time. That's this particular idea I want you to deal with this week. And just like last week, I want you to think about giving me a blog post which lets me see and then see how you understand this idea. So on your blogs, I'd like you to think about time, think about the things that we've looked at today. And I want you to post something where you think you have a sense or a feeling that time is also changing for you. How is your relationship with each other or with apps or with a network or with Skype or with SMS technologies or with letters or with networks? I don't know. But have a think about how you might have felt when you get caught in a St. Augustine moment. When are you confused? Also, when are you tied, you find yourself tied absolutely to timetables and you find yourself utterly bored because you can't spend it. Having said that, many people like trains because they can buy time because nobody can get hold of them. What's it like to be dealing with technological determinism? What are you going to promise me? Apple are promising me that the iPhone 5S is terrific, and I'm sure the rumours will start for the 6, which will make it twice as fast and twice as cool. When do you begin to find yourself caught in conditions where you're reading data, not reality, because the real time is being fed to you through data and not the things in front of you? When is the city perhaps portrayed as a confusing idea of real time? When is Edinburgh in a real time? So all of these things I want you to think about and give me examples. If you want to do what I do, which is throw me cultural examples, such as movies, please do. I always want to add more, and maybe we can add them to the list of design informatics movies that we all need to watch. Right, that's all for now. Bye.